have two meetings tonight. One, we will begin with this evening, which is the Board of Liquor and Tobacco Control. So I'd like to call that meeting to order. It's 5:30, December 2nd, 2024. Brent, do we have any agenda changes or additions?
No.
Okay. We need to approve the minutes of November 18th, 2024. We'll look for a motion to do that, but I'd just like to mention that there's a couple of typos in it. Calling the board to order, my last name is spelled incorrectly, and in approving the minutes, the motion was made by Richard Craig, and that needs to be corrected as well. It's the only two changes, so when you make the motion to approve the minutes, if you just say as amended, Judy can make those corrections. So I'd entertain a motion.
I'll make a motion to approve the minutes with the corrections that Chris noted.
Okay, and that is for a meeting of November 18th, 2024.
Yeah, November 18th, 2024.
Okay, is there a second?
Second.
Okay, so we have a motion by Richard and a second by George. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion to approve the minutes, say aye.
Aye.
Okay, that would be unanimous, Judy. My understanding is that there is no liquor license application this evening, nor a tobacco license application. Is that correct? Okay, so what we would be acting on tonight is a request for a catering permit at Green Mountain Distillers. It is usual and customary to see if there's any issues as far as Morristown Police Department is concerned. I think Brent talked with Jason today and found none. Is that correct?
Correct.
Okay. So Green Mountain Distillers would like to do a catering at their facility at 2919 Layport Road. It's going to be December 14th, 2024 from 12 to 7. It's their Christmas party. I would entertain a motion to approve a catering permit.
I'll make a motion to approve a catering permit for 12/14/2024 for Green Mountain Distillers from 12 to 7.
Okay, and is there a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion? Seeing none, hearing none, all those in favor of the catering permit for Green Mountain Distillers LLC, say aye.
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 All right, that would be unanimous, Judy. With no other business for the board, I would entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Okay.
Second.
Okay, so we have a motion by George, a second by Richard to adjourn. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
That would be unanimous as well. Thank you. So it is 5:33, it's December 2nd, 2024. Monday evening, we'll call the select board meeting to order.
Chris, we go.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's okay. I'm just getting, I had one, two screens at the same time, so I have two meetings, so.
Well, you got two hands, right?
I got two, got one. Yep, so I got two screens to work on. Okay, that one's good. We called it to order.
Okay, do you want me to repeat that?
Go right ahead.
Okay, so it is Monday evening, December 2nd, 2024, 5:33 PM. We will call the select board meeting to order. Was that a good grunt or a bad grunt?
That was an okay grunt.
Okay. Are we good?
I'm learning things all the time about this system. I can't run two meetings simultaneously. So I have another BMDF meeting and we'll run them both together on the system for the select board. So good there. And I just need for MDF to call their meeting to order.
Okay, we'll call the meeting to order at 5:37. According to that clock, Chris, I don't know if that's the same as yours.
It is now. And the only other thing that I would want to mention is that part of our select board meeting, is there any agenda changes or additions, Brent?
No.
Okay. So MDF board is in order as well as the select board. And our goal tonight is to consider and approve and sign MDF documents. The Morristown Development Fund has approached the town about going into agreement to transfer assets to the town of Morristown. Do you want to give us some history, Sarah, about it?
About the MDF fund?
Sure.
Probably Steve or Mary Ann probably could give more history than I could.
No, he's the history man.
Well, Chris, this has been going on for, I want to say, 15 years.
Oh, my.
And it started with David Crawford as the town administrator, and we're finally getting there. So the MDF fund incorporated will be turned over to the town of Morristown. You will appoint a committee, as I understand it.
Yeah.
That will review the loans and make the loans, and you will outsource a lot of the paperwork with the, what do I want to call it, Brent?
Loan servicer.
Thank you, yes. And it should, I hope, we all hope, that it will flow nicely, better than it has in the past.
Yep. All right. The loan servicer would be an RFP to take a look at certain parameters, and we'll talk about that a little bit.
Yes.
As we work through the documentation. So the first exhibit that we're going to be talking about tonight is Exhibit A. It's the Morristown Development Fund Asset Transfer Agreement. It's a resolution. And for the record, there are two pools of money that currently exist in the Morristown Development Fund. One is an Edward Jones investment account. It has $570,974.52. And the second is a Union Bank money market account that has $8,703.76. The everybody's had an opportunity to review this document.
Yes. We have.
Okay. Are there any questions about the document?
I have one. Sure. Maybe two. Are there any outstanding loans or uncollectible loans on this one?
There are uncollectible loans, George.
Okay.
There is, I guess you could call them still outstanding.
Okay.
But there's no way to collect.
Okay. And we don't need the name here, but I assume Tina has
yes.
documentation.
Yes.
On
yeah.
The uncollectible.
Yeah.
Okay.
She has that all.
Okay. Thank you. That was my question.
Did you have another one, George?
That's it.
Okay. Any other questions? Okay. Tonight, we would need two motions. One is from the MDF current board, and another is from the select board.
So, are we ready to make a motion?
Yes. Yes.
Who would like to move it?
I
there's a
I
motion, can, there's a motion
yeah.
on your memo page that mm-hmm.
I would move to approve the Morristown Development Fund Asset Transfer Agreement as presented and authorize the chair, Steve Leach, to sign.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Okay.
Who is the second?
Sam.
Thank you very much.
So there's a motion made by Mary Ann authorizing me to sign the documents giving the money to the town. Or turn it over to the town. It's always been theirs. Sam seconded. Is there any discussion? Any questions? If not, all in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? It's unanimous, and I so declare it.
The select board now needs to, in turn, make a motion to approve the Development Fund Asset Transfer Agreement, so I would entertain a motion to do that.
I'll make the motion to approve the Morristown Development Fund Asset Transfer Agreement as presented and authorize the Vice Chair, Chris Palermo, to sign.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. A motion made by George and a second by Richard. Is there any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? That would be unanimous, Judy. The next order of business is what we call Exhibit B. This is Town of Morristown Selectboard Resolution regarding the establishment of a Morristown Development Loan Fund Advisory Committee. This would be a board that would have 5 members, one that would have a 4-year term that expires in 3/2028, a 3-year term that expires 3/2027, a 2-year term that expires 3/2026, 1-year term that expires 3/2025, and then the select board member is appointed annually in that. Just so that everybody understands that once that term that the individual is appointed to, once it comes to be expired, then it becomes alternating 3-year terms. So it would be staggered afterwards. Is there any questions about the establishment of the advisory committee? None? Okay. I think that we would make a motion to approve and sign the resolution regarding the establishment. What?
I think there needs to be discussion about if tonight members can be
reappointed.
Decided.
Okay. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. So the current members, as I understand it, is Steve, Sam Guy, Marion Wilson, Laura Streets, and I'm not sure who the...
Peter Merrill.
Merrill.
Okay.
I'm the select board.
Right.
She's the liaison.
Right, but you're a part of the board, the
right.
MDF board.
Just for clarification.
So in terms of your ability and willingness, I guess, to continue to serve on the MDF board, we would let you decide, and I don't know if anybody's talked to Mr. Merrill at this point. Does he draw the short straw on the 4-year term? Or, but at the end of the day, if you would like to continue to serve, then I think that you should let us know, and then we would make that as part of the motion.
I will stay on until March of 2025.
So you would be willing to do the 1-year term expiring? Okay. Is there anybody that's willing to do the 2-year term?
I'll do it.
Okay. I'm going to do the 3. I'll do the 2.
Sam, you did the 3?
No, I did the 2.
Oh, you said 3.
All right, I'm stuck between a rock and a hard place now.
So, Sam, you're going to do the 2-year.
I'll do it. Yes, thank you. I'm older than you. I need to retire.
So, I have to, I'll do the 3-year, and Peter will have to do the 4-year.
So, has anybody talked with Peter about his interest in, you know, staying on the board?
He's traveling a lot. I don't know. Okay. My feeling is he probably is not going to want to stay, but.
For the purposes of this, if he decided to resign, then we would go through a normal advertisement for the, we're filling the term, unexpired term at this point, once we reach the agreement. Is that how you would understand
yeah.
that?
Yeah.
Okay. Anything else that I am remiss in talking about in terms of the agreement?
No, it was just pointing. You need, when you say your motion, you're going to need to put names in the
term. Okay. Yep, perfect. So I guess I would entertain a motion to approve and sign, including names and dates of terms in a motion.
So this would be a select
board. Right.
And is Laura going to stay on as select board liaison in this motion?
Yep.
Okay.
Her term is, she was appointed for the year.
Okay.
So it'd be a reappointment in March. Right.
I'll move to approve and sign the Town of Morristown Select Board Resolution regarding the establishment of the Morristown Development Fund Loan Advisory Committee as presented, with the members being appointed as follows. Steve Leach for a term expiring 3/25 to the MDF Loan Advisory Committee. Sam Guy for a two-year term expiring 3/26 to the MDF Loan Advisory Committee. Mary Ann Wilson for a three-year term expiring 3/27 to the MDF Loan Advisory Committee. Peter Merrill for a four-year term expiring 3/28 to the MDF Loan Advisory Committee. Laura Streets as a Select Board representative for a one-year term expiring 3/25 to the MDF Loan Advisory Committee.
Okay, is there a second?
Second.
All right, so we have a motion by Richard and a second by George. Is there any other discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the resolution to establish the Morristown Development Loan Advisory Committee, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That would be unanimous. And just so you know, there's documents that we're going to need to sign before we leave this evening, so bear with us for that. Exhibit C. This is a corporate resolution for the Morristown Development Fund, and I'll just take a moment and read it. We, the undersigned, being the directors of Morristown Development Fund, Inc., consent and agree that Morristown Development Fund, Inc. shall be dissolved in accordance with the provisions of Title 11B, Chapter 14 of the Vermont Statutes annotated, and the president be duly authorized to take all such actions as may be required to accomplish the same, including without limitation, executing such documents as may be required or appropriate to effectuate the transfer of all assets of the Morristown Development Fund, Inc. to the town of Morristown, Vermont. So that would be a MDF, MDF motion, Steve.
Yes, so do I hear a motion?
Go ahead.
I'll do it. Motion to approve this, approve and sign the warrant that, geez. Motion to approve and sign Morristown Development Fund corporate resolution as presented.
Is there a second?
Second.
The motion has been made and seconded to sign over the fund of the town. Is there any discussion? Any questions? Any concerns? If not, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed? It is passed, unanimous, and I so declare it. Thank you.
Okay. Moving on, we have Exhibit B, which is MDF Loan Program Guidelines. And it basically lays out committee membership terms. It also has the requirements for quorum, officers and staff, responsibilities and authority, liability. It speaks to the loan servicer, which will be assisting the MDF Loan Advisory Committee, and the loan fund objectives, borrow eligibility, eligible activity, security, and loan types. I would entertain a motion from the Select Board.
Question.
Yeah, let's do the motion.
You want to do the motion? Sorry,
and
yes,
and
I apologize.
Then
yeah.
Then we'll do the discussion if that's okay.
Sorry. I'll make a motion to approve and sign Morristown Development Fund Loan Program Guidelines as presented.
Okay, is there a second?
Second.
Okay, we have a motion by Richard and a second by George. Let's have discussion. George.
The loan servicer, it's just informational. Is there a current loan servicer?
No.
So if we were to have a loan, we would need to go out and do the RFP.
Right.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. That's all I had.
Well, yeah, we won't be doing a loan servicer per application. We'll put an RFP out for loan servicers that will service all the applications coming in.
Mm.
Okay. Just want to clarify that.
Mm-hmm.
Good, thank you.
Okay, Chris, my question is, the redlined document, these are all incorporated in the final document?
Yes.
Okay.
Everyone, if I may?
Sure, absolutely.
We wanted to show the red line to the Select Board and the fund members so that you could see that those, what the latest changes were. I mean, as you know, there's been multiple review, multiple changes, but there are a couple final ones.
Okay.
Is there any other questions? We have a motion on the table to approve and sign the Morristown Development Fund Loan Program Guidelines as presented. There's a motion by Richard and a second by George. Is there any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? It carries unanimously. Judy. Okay, I think finally we have Exhibit E, which is a request for proposals for loan services for the Morristown Development Fund. Basically outlines the background of the fund, the proposed scope of services that we would be looking for from the loan servicer, loan monitoring, loan collection, consultation, and an evaluation of specific criteria. It also goes on to, with requested information, submission of responses, and reservations. So I would entertain a motion to approve the Town of Morristown request for proposals as presented.
I'll make a motion to approve the Town of Morristown request for proposals as presented.
Is there a second?
Second.
All right, second by Richard. Is there any discussion or questions?
I assume we'll be in the loop on this a little bit.
Of course.
Good, thank you.
It's a joint effort. Any questions or concerns? Okay, so we have a motion by George and a second by Richard to approve the Town of Morristown request for proposals as presented. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The motion carries unanimously. So Judy, you have some things, or Brent has some things that we should sign.
I would just like to say this is, I'm the newest to this board, and I like to say it's, I've been very impressed. This was a long time coming, this changeover, and I really appreciate everyone's effort in expediting this and getting this, because it's a lot of money we can get out of the community.
Steve.
And so I'd like to thank you all, and I think it's a great thing that we're moving this forward.
So we should fill in the names here.
Today's the second, right?
Today's the second.
Steve or Stephen?
Oh, yeah.
Stephen. Correct. So Steve is four.
So, Steve, this is the corporate resolution that you passed.
Uh-huh.
This is a signature page for the MDF to sign. So I'll have you go ahead and sign it and pass it around.
He's drawing the short stick. He was four.
Peter.
Oh, that's right.
Sorry.
Oh, yeah. You want the printed name there so you can read it?
Sure.
Sam guy. Stephen Meech.
Table with this one.
This is signed, Brent. These two don't need signatures. So George, signature for you and Laura.
Okay.
Make sure you spell your name right, George.
L-E-A-C-H.
Correct.
George.
Thank you.
That's Dawn, okay.
Feeling like you're in the middle?
So to fill this, you'll have, you'll put a candidate thing out if Peter doesn't take it.
Yeah, there's a process.
Yeah.
You would fill the remainder, but sure.
Yeah. Good people. Here's the.
No, not at all. So I think, believe that that concludes our.
Perfect.
Business tonight, so I would entertain a motion from the select board to, I guess we don't need, I guess we're done, you do.
We need to adjourn, so.
I think it's appropriate to thank all these people.
Absolutely.
The work they've done in the past and the work they're willing to continue. So thank you all.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
And I would entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Mary Ann, second?
Sam, second.
Any discussion? If not.
Do we need to set a meeting?
I was just going to comment that we'll be reaching out to all of you. Judy will be reaching out and scheduling a follow-up meeting.
Okay. All right. All those in favor of adjournment, aye?
Aye.
Unanimous. Thank you. Thank you.
Good timing, Judy.
Don't spend it all in one place.
Enjoy.
Happy holidays.
Have a good holiday, Mary.
Me too.
Enjoy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Again, Chris.
Thank you, Steve.
Take care.
Yeah, you too.
Thank you. I'll be in touch. And I need a little more.
Give yourself a little more room.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
It's the last article, the last item.
Yeah.
And then Todd asked if I would make the select board aware of this meeting going on, that Ryan was a good people.
Yeah.
And I obliged.
All right, first order of business for us this evening is to approve the minutes of November 18th, 2024. I would entertain a motion.
I'll make a motion to approve the minutes of 11-18, 2024.
Okay, Richard, is there a second?
Second.
By George. I do want to just point out, I don't know if Judy's already corrected this, but Brent's name on page two, very top of the page, it said thank Brent Reynolds for his work. So I just wanted to make that note. So if you would include that in your motion and second as amended.
So I'll make a motion to approve the minutes of 11-18-2024 with the correction of Brent Reynolds to Brent Raymond on page two.
Okay, George, you would second that amended motion?
Second the amendment, yes.
Okay, is there any other discussion? Hearing none, We have a motion by Richard and a second by George. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And that would be unanimous. All right, thank you. So the next on our agenda is a right-of-way permit that's being applied for by Eurofins Environmental Testing. I believe we have a gentleman here this evening that would like to take a moment and kind of walk us through. When you come to the mic, if you would introduce yourself, that would be great for our viewing audience.
My name's Steve Hilfiger. I work for VHB, an environmental consulting company. And Eurofins Environmental Testing is a subcontractor. They also provide drilling services, which is why they're listed on the right-of-way permit. So this is a continuation of the soil vapor investigation that we conducted this summer. I don't recall the exact month. I believe it was July. So we had applied for a right-of-way permit there with two different drillers. And just one small portion is continuing on with this driller. So installation of two soil vapor points in the road right of way to evaluate for chlorinated volatile organic compounds in soil vapor beneath the road. They can follow utility corridors, et cetera. That's the reason the state is asking us to look into that for them.
Okay. This is proposed to start at the end of this week, is that correct?
On Friday.
Okay. And two locations. One is, I think, almost across from the Bijou Theater, is that correct?
Correct, yeah, right in front of 110 Portland Street.
Yep. And then the other one is at elbow bend of Pleasant Street and Railroad Street, is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay. These are 3-inch diameter soil borings through the roadway to go no deeper than 10 feet below the grade surface.
Correct.
Okay. Is there anything else that you'd like to add?
I can just talk about the construction of these. It'll follow the same methodologies last time, if any of y'all have seen those. So once we install this point, it's a 6-inch stainless steel screen cylinder connected with tubing. And the void space that isn't filled by that small diameter tubing and the stainless steel screen is backfilled with sand. And then there's a bentonite plug that's put in to prevent water infiltration. Should any make it into the road box or be running underneath the pavement, we don't want it going down into that hole and washing out all the backfilled material. Then above the bentonite plug, we put a small concrete apron to hold the road box in place. And then we put I want to say it's approximately 4 to 6 inch diameter road box. We try to put the top flush or slightly recessed from the roadway so that the plow trucks don't rip those out. And we use an asphalt saw to cut the asphalt before we install the concrete apron.
Is there a timeline for how long these will be in the ground?
If the state would like continued monitoring, they may request those stay in longer. Right now, it's more of an investigation of what is the extent of the soil vapor plume, and therefore what buildings should be evaluated for potential soil vapor underneath the building and potential intrusion in indoor air. So these will help us better understand the direction this is going. But if I had to give a guess, I'd say until the select board would like them removed. The state would love as many data points as possible and for them not to go away, but again, if they need to go, then they need to go. They understand that.
What's the minimum time needed to collect enough data to make an assessment?
So we'll be collecting the samples the following week, so approximately a week from today, maybe a day or two later, you know, midweek. And then we get the data back about 2 to 3 weeks after the samples have been submitted to the laboratory. So there's about a day of shipping to get to the lab, and then they process them. So I'd say by the end of December, hopefully we get some results before the holidays and the labs slow down.
So it's not like every week they're taking samples. It's really kind of...
That's correct. Sometimes the state requests a second sample just to verify the concentrations that were identified in the first sample. But not always, specifically with these types of points, not always.
Brent, did you have any questions? Or Any comments?
No, like you said, they did something very similar this summer. There were no issues that we're aware of, and so, you know, this is needed, and my recommendation is approval.
Can I just ask a clarification, because we have now authorized the highway superintendent to oversee the right-of-way permits? Did we not do that?
That was not approved. We need to make updates.
Okay.
So we're still working under the old process.
Just wanted to clarify, thank you.
So the other one's been covered up, the ones that we did in June, are they still?
They're still existing. They still exist and are visible, yeah. Yeah.
Just curious about that.
We typically leave them in place unless we're specifically asked to remove them at a certain point, just in case something else comes up and another sample's requested by the state.
Okay.
Brent, has the highway superintendent reviewed plans and are okay with this? I'm looking at the 2001 policy.
Yeah, so Jordan was made aware of it, and he doesn't have any concerns at this time. I'm sure, knowing him, the brief time he's worked here, that he'll be occasionally doing his own inspection, but he has no concerns, but he's voiced to me.
And who handles traffic control? I mean, the one that's at the elbow of Railroad and Pleasant seems to be relatively out of the way, but the one.
That's a great question.
Right in front of the Bijou is.
Are the contractors handling that? Because we weren't requested to, that I know of, or like, if we were, we missed it.
We specifically cited these in locations that we thought would be out of the main lane of travel. So in front of 110 Portland Street, I believe there's a parking spot there. In all reality, that one might not be able to go in due to the, there's a lot of underground utilities in that location and some sort of obstruction, maybe a concrete pad. So whether it was an old roadway or protecting something, we don't really want to find out the hard way. So we specifically try and cite these in locations where flagging wouldn't be.
So would you be, I guess I'm not sure what size drill rig there is, so would you be on the sidewalk? How would a parking space give you enough room to work with whatever equipment you need?
It's the size of two of these tables pushed together to create a rectangle, about 5 feet wide and maybe a little bit longer.
Okay.
So it's quite small, mounted tracks. And they're in and out, they're pretty quick. They use direct push tooling that gets them down 5 feet, clear the soil, 5 more feet.
Okay, thank you.
So I'm curious, because you do have two dig safe permits for those spots. Are you, at least it's part of our package here, that expire 12/18/2024. You have concerns about the Portland Street drilling site?
Just due to the subsurface infrastructure there. We had a private utility locator, as well as dig safe and Morrisville Water and Light come out and mark things up and pre-clear locations. And that one, it seemed like the juice wasn't worth the squeeze there. There was some concerns about the locations of utilities, and ultimately the state said, look, if you don't feel comfortable putting that one in, don't put it in.
So chances are the only one that you'd be doing is on Railroad Street and Pleasant Street.
That's correct.
Could you be coming back with a different location for the one that?
At this point, no, the work plan's approved by the state and they're ready to move forward.
So, okay. So any other questions from the board? I would entertain a motion then to approve the right-of-way permit.
I'll move to approve the right-of-way permit for Eurofins environmental testing as presented and authorize the vice chair, Chris Palermo, to sign it.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, so we have a motion by George and a second by Richard. Is there any further discussion? Is there any questions? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The motion is carried unanimously, Judy. Thank you. Thank you. So the next thing on our agenda is to discuss the housing committee letter to the select board. Is there somebody here that would like to speak to that?
Good evening, Todd Thomas, I staff your housing committee. So you have a letter in your packet from the housing committee talking about tax stabilization for future affordable housing development. That was one of the tools that was in within this board's purview recommended in the state housing needs assessment. And the letter is pretty self-explanatory. Bob Bortry's here from the committee. I think Judy Bickford's online. And let me know if you have any questions. Happy to help if you do.
Judy Bickford is online.
Okay.
She is the bottom.
Okay, good. Just so the board and staff have, I took the liberty, they referenced two state statutes in their letter to the board. So I printed it off and highlighted the referred to.
Thank you.
Just so that you have their understanding about what the, what they're speaking to.
Thank you.
That's one of them. And this is the other one.
Thank you.
Thanks, Chris.
So the letter sent by the Morristown Housing Committee is essentially asking the select board to consider some sort of tax stabilization for the development for affordable housing in Morristown. And the crux of it, of the letter is sort of midsection. It says that their board respectfully requests that the select board agree to offer tax stabilization on all new commercial, AKA multifamily housing developments that contain a percentage of affordable housing that is deed restricted per a VSA, 24 VSA 43031 and 2, which you have. As most of these future development sites will come from vacant or underutilized land, we recommend any municipal tax stabilization grant per 24 VSA 2741A1 be fixed and maintained at the value of the property at the time of the request for a five-year period. So the statutes talk about options, particularly the one that speaks to, it would be 2741. If you look at that, it shows that a municipal corporation has four options to fix or maintain property tax for development of affordable housing. The one that they are proposing to us is number one, fixing and maintaining a valuation of such property in the grand list. The others go on to fixing and maintaining the rate of rates, rate or rates of tax applicable to such property, fixing the amount of money which shall be paid as an annual tax upon such property, or fixing the tax applicable to such property, a percentage of the annual tax. That's the one I am most familiar with. In my previous history, we did a number of tax stabilizations for both commercial development as well as housing. My first blush at this, and I'm open to any other discussion, obviously, is that I'm not sure that fixing and maintaining the value of the property at the time of the request for a five-year period moves the needle a whole lot. I understand that if the property is evaluated for $500,000 and put $1.5 million in it, it stabilizes it at $500,000. But I think that is that enough incentive for developers to do that. And I guess the other question I would have is, you know, if by the requirements that you see in here, in the second statute that I passed out, that the affordable housing development means housing development of which at least 20% of the units or a minimum of 5 units, whichever is greater, for are affordable housing units. So if somebody puts in a 60-unit development, and they use 20% of that, you're giving tax stabilization to full retail market rents. And you take a look at just the appraised value of what the affordable housing units are. I think that in concept, I'm really in favor of this because there is very little affordable housing anywhere. I mean, we've become a community and state of have and have nots. And I think that this absolutely should be an agenda item for us to take a look at. So I fully endorse it. I just think that the meat of the subject, how we get there and how we propose this really needs to take a much finer look rather than just the recommendation that comes from the committee. I appreciate very much that they've been working on this. They've offered some really great information in their letter to us. And I think that it's needed and it's good that they have brought this to us, but I think that we really need to spend some time and take a look at how we could do this. You know, is it brand new construction? Is it renovated construction? Do we need a different metric for each one of those? I think that there's a lot of things to consider. So that's my initial thoughts on it. I'd like to hear from the rest of the board and perhaps from Bob and anybody else that's on the committee.
My initial reaction to it is I had the concern about, because I looked at the 2741 statute, sub A, the fixing and maintaining of the valuation of such property in the grand list for 5 years, is what happens in year 6 when it bumps up to full valuation. Does the landlord then take a significant hit, getting used to 5 years of reduced taxation? How does that react? And does that mean rents become untenable as the landlord tries to recoup the change? I don't have an answer to that, but I wonder about that. As I read it as well, the option 4, the one about establishing some kind of a percentage of the annual tax over a number of years, whether that be 5 or 10 years, with increasing percentage of the tax being paid, strikes me as a better way to ease a landlord and therefore the tenants into full valuation. But I'm certainly open to other conversations as well. But the first one seems so cut and dry that it's great for the first 5 years and then it's all gone. And I'm not sure how that transitions, especially on, let's say, a smaller development, smaller multifamily that's got the minimum of 5. If that bump in the tax has to be distributed amongst 5 tenants, that's a could be a fairly good sized hit that the landlord's got to pass on. And I understand the landlord's got to pass it on. Obviously, they're not owning a building for just general benefit. They're clearly looking to make a reasonable profit. That's my first reaction to it.
So I think that, you know, part of that discussion, George, is really twofold. One is that the affordable housing statute sets specific parameters in terms of percentage of gross annual income of a household. And so, you know, whatever leverage would happen beyond would fall onto the non-affordable housing units as designated. Mm-hmm. You know, my experience in the past, both in new construction and renovated construction, is the fact that we did it over a 10-year period, started out at 10%. And annually went up, so there was a gradual bump up as an incentivization to promote affordable housing. So if somebody, you know, particularly if they were going to do a whole complex affordable housing, that would give them a 10-year window to build to a certain to full value on it. I don't know what other tax considerations affordable housing brings in terms of how, you know, whether they get rebates from federal or state agencies to help defer any of those expenses, but that's typically my experience. The other way would be to do it over 5 years where you do 20, you know, 40, 60, 80, 100. So again, I think that there's some real consideration of how we approach this, and I think it certainly should be doable. I just think that we need to give it some thought and also take a look at any other communities around that have walked down this path in terms of incentivizing this type of development and see how they approach it as well.
And Chris, in your experience, I'm going to assume that this is municipal tax only.
It is
not education tax. Therefore, since we all know the majority of our local property taxes towards education, this is a less than 50% of the tax bill that each of us pays for property is subject to, you know, this discussion. But the other part of that for the landlord is going to be what it is under non-residential education tax calculations.
That's correct.
Okay.
Yeah, the only thing that we control is the municipal side of the ledger. Yeah. Richard?
Yeah, I think it's, we're between a rock and a hard place with this. But it does say here, minimum of 15 years, the affordable units preserve their affordability for a minimum of 15 years. I don't know how a developer is going to want to develop if they're not making their full money on a number of units.
And what happens if they find they can't do that and they just say, we're not doing affordable housing anymore? Right. Have they gotten the tax stabilization and now they realize that's not financially functional?
We're not going to develop in Morristown.
Or that for the next time? Yep. So I agree with Chris. I think this is a good idea, but we need to flush it out.
I would agree. I think we need a lot more details. My first observation as we head into the budget talks is that I think we have to tread very lightly on giving tax stabilization. And I think when everybody sees the budget, you're going to understand why. And with the state just came out and said that we're facing a 5.9% education for next year after a 13% this year. I think there will be a lot of pushback on giving developers a break, because in past people have wanted impact fees and lots of other things that have never been put in. So I think it's a much bigger conversation. As much as I hate to say it, I think the timing is just really bad, because we're about to get hit. I mean, I've been doing a lot of research, and it's not going to be pretty what's coming. It's going to be very volatile. I'm already looking at, you know, we're going to save that conversation. But I will say, I have friends who live in California. And in California, they just said, you build a building, you have to have an affordable, you have to have one unit that's affordable housing, no matter how luxury, how fancy, everybody has to have one. And that's working very well in California. A lot more units, but I just am really hesitant to, we need a lot more information.
I tend to be more glasses half full on it. And to Morristown's credit, from the school side of the ledger, they came in probably half of what the state average was this year.
That's true.
They came in at around 6-7, maybe a little less. So I think that everybody from the municipal side as well as the education side has their pencils sharpened and their erasers ready to go. And I think that I'm not anywhere near as doom and gloom about this. I think it's a conversation that we need to have. There's plenty of people out there that can't afford to live in Morristown because of their income. and would like to raise their families here in this small measure, I'd like to take a good hard look at it. So there's no action that needs to take place on this. It's just for discussion. Bob, would you like to speak to that? And I would invite Judy maybe as well too.
Yeah, Chris, Bob Wartry, I'm on the Housing Committee. With regards to your feeling that this isn't going to be much of an incentive for a developer, this is a two-pronged approach. We've gone to the village trustees as well and have asked for some leeway in their pricing for hookup for utilities. There's no easy answer, but people need places to live. And if we stick our head in the sand and do nothing, this is just going to get worse and worse and worse. And we're going to see more crime. We're going to see more people sleeping on the streets, more people camped out along the rail trail. I don't think it's a lot to ask for seed. Granted, it isn't probably the sledgehammer that's needed, and I don't think that would work, but at least we could do something that says that we care, that we want to help. If we do nothing, what message does that send to all these people? But I don't feel good about it. I have a house to live in. We all do, but a lot of people do not. And I just think that we need to be compassionate. Even if it costs a little bit out of our pocket, we need to be able to find that. And I would agree with Chris that the Housing Committee would love to have your input, your thoughts, your ideas. This is just a first blush at what can we do? How can we help? I look at this and I know it's not perfect. I know there are a lot of things that are not spelled out that need to be spelled out, but we wanted to make the presentation so to plant a seed for more information to come in, ideas, how can we make this work? How can we help people? And so with that, I hope that you will consider ways that this might work for our community and all the people that need a place to live. Thank you.
Bob, I appreciate all of your efforts as a committee, and I think that you should feel good about planting that seed. Yep, I was just going to ask if she'd like to weigh in as well.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. Can
yes,
you hear
we can.
Me?
Yes.
Okay, good. Thank you. I agree with what everybody is saying, that this is just a proposal we put forward just to start a conversation, and definitely willing to look at other alternatives and different ways of tweaking this. And most of you are probably aware that the state is doing its own housing assessment, and that information is going to be coming out to the towns, and the towns are going to be able, I don't know how a state's going to do it, but the assessment's going to say each town is responsible for so many units of housing to build and put forth. So we're starting somewhere. We had to start somewhere, and we used the assessment that was done by Mr. Kennedy, and it gave us this piece of information that we're putting forth to you. So it's just a start, and I appreciate you taking our letting us speak to you at the meeting today. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Judy. Does anybody else have any thoughts or comments?
The one thing the committee, speaking for the larger committee, was looking for, are you open to the concept? What we're trying to do is put together a list of menu options of why a developer might be able to do this here, and this is one of the components. So it's this, there's a planning one, there's a village trustee one. We're just trying to see if you're open to it. It sounds like Chris is, Laura may not, which is okay. What about the,
No, I'm open to it.
Okay.
I will say my concern at this point is keeping people in their homes and keeping the people that live here, here. That's the, right, my concern today.
Understood.
This is long-term, and so I think it's a great start. I think conceptually, it's worth reviewing and kind of vetting it out to see what's possible. I'm not, it's not gonna happen today. So that's all I'm saying, is that this, we need to spend some time. But I think, you know, I think you guys did a lot of work. I think it's a reasonable and great place to start.
Okay. If, I mean, it's, we're just trying to figure out if it's a viable option, if Richard or George want to speak.
I would like to see us move forward with something like this, but it needs, we need to make sure it's viable for developers and the community. That's, it's a lot, right? For one night for us to try to come up with, fix this.
Yeah.
I mean, that's where, kind of where I'm at, is like, let's like look at this as a community and figure out what we need to do, because I agree with, like,
yeah, we don't have a project.
My kids can't afford to live here, right?
We don't have a project, obviously, right now. So there's nothing to actually physically give you right now.
Right.
We're just trying to make sure the town is open to the idea. And we've done tax stabilization many times before. We've always done option one. It's been used quite frequently here. We've never used option four, but it doesn't mean we can't do it, obviously.
I would agree with everything that said, Todd. I absolutely think we have a significant need in this community for affordable housing. And we can't do it solely on the backs of the Model Housing Partnership. As much as they try, they can't meet the need on their own. I think we need to do something more to stimulate private growth, and this is one of the ways to do that. As everyone else has said, it's a start. Is it the right start? Well, it's a start, it's a good start. Is it the right direction? I'm not sure that option one versus two versus three versus four, until we work it out more, and at some point start to put some numbers on it as to how impactful is it on the tax rate, depending on some variable on numbers. But as far as continuing to work on this, absolutely, yes.
I think that gives us the feedback we're looking for, Bob.
I think so, yeah.
I do, thank you for your time, I appreciate it.
The more feedback we get, the more tools we have in the toolbox to work with. This is just basically ideas at this point. What can we do?
Yeah. I agree with you, Bob. You know, when you ride the rail trail on your bike or walk it, and you see what goes for tents, and that's stretching the terminology,
and I think
that's inappropriate in our town. As much as we can fix it, we may never get to fix all of it, but that's not the side of Morristown that I want to highlight. It's not at all correct.
And I definitely think we've got to open the conversation with the developers. Because I've heard from a lot of them over years the drawbacks. So we need to open up the conversation and let it be known that we're willing to work with them. You know, I think is the bigger part, and that, you know, they may have some very specifics. I know they've mentioned, you know, the permitting process through the state has been prohibitive. So I think it's a great place, but I think the sooner we bring in the developers into the conversation, the better.
I believe Todd was going to talk to a couple of developers and builders to see if there was, what their thoughts were on, you know, how the big developers are not going to be interested in this. I don't think so. I think it's going to be the mid to small developer who sees an opportunity to be able to do something. The big developers, probably not. That's my own personal feeling. But again, we're just looking for feedback, ideas, different ideas. We just have to start somewhere and at least acknowledge that we have a problem and we're thinking about it and seeing if we can come up with a plan to move forward. And thank you very much for accepting our letter and considering it. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Bob. Thank you, Judy.
Thank you.
There's nothing else. We'll continue to move forward with the agenda. I think next up is Tasha Wallace from LCPC. Welcome, Tasha.
Hi, thank you so much for having me.
I really appreciate the time today. Really, this is kind of a customer service visit. I haven't been to this select board in a while. I know that our staff has been actively working with Brent on a whole range of activities related to transportation, energy, et cetera. And we want to make sure that you're aware of all our services and that we are providing the excellent level of service that we aspire to for all of our towns in the region. I'm also super excited that I'm here right after the governing board of the Lamoille County Planning Commission approved Morristown and Morrisville's town plan.
Finally.
It's very exciting news, and I really appreciate the compassion around housing, because approving the plan can really help move the affordable housing discussion forward. As you know, the next step is to obtain a downtown designation from the state. Once you have downtown designation, and also you're eligible for municipal planning grants, and the state has shared with us that they would be very open to a municipal planning grant application from the community to assist in achieving that downtown designation. And we would be happy to help you with that application. But a couple of really important things is once you achieve downtown designation with the new land use legislation, housing projects would be exempt from the Act 250 process. Right. Not just in the designated downtown area, but within a half mile radius around that. And so you mentioned earlier the state permit process. So that I think is a really important and exciting opportunity to add to your quiver, not to mention the tax credits that are available to private developers once downtown designation is achieved. If you look around this community, some of the really nice buildings in the downtown have previously received those tax credits, such as the redevelopment of the Arthur store where the coffee store is now, the Union Bank, one of the buildings, I'm forgetting which, right here on the street here. So I think, and we can provide a list to the community. So I think
it was Power Play, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was a Power Play building. Yeah.
Power Play.
Okay. Yep. And so all of those things provide tremendous opportunity. It also allows the community to be eligible for community development block grant funds and various transportation funds under downtown designation. There's also downtown transportation funding. And I know a member of our staff has been conducting a sidewalk inventory for this community. And some of those funds could be used for sidewalks as well. So I think that this is, and we're just really excited to be working with this community going forward. Super, super. And another thing, now that you have an approved plan, I wanted to remind the select board about the enhanced energy planning process as well. There are three towns in Lamoille County that do not have an enhanced energy plan as part of their town plan, and that's Morristown, Belvedere, and Eden. And if you decide to move forward with an enhanced energy planning process, and it does take a lot of work, but what it does give to the community is substantial deference in the Act 248 process if there are energy projects being cited in your community. And so the town plan has a lot more sway over those projects and in that process. And we do have a member of the staff who's very accomplished in that area, and I'm sure she'd be happy to present to the select board about what that might entail. And excuse me, my wrist is ringing at me. and I know that you are interested in energy issues because you successfully applied working with our staff for the MERP, the Municipal Enhancement. I can't remember how much funding you got, but it's
a
nice
lot.
Chunk.
Yeah.
Yes.
$173,000.
Yes. Yes. To improve.
And some change.
Yes.
And so what, that's what we're here for, is we're here to help you find the money and do the projects. And I also want to remind you that we have, you have appointees on a transportation advisory committee, and we do a lot of transportation planning work. We do pretty much do traffic counts for almost every community every summer. We can do speed measures, turning counts, and we've helped communities find grants for specific transportation projects or analyses, and we'd like to assist you with all of those. So I'm really here, after all that, to answer any questions and offer any assistance on any front. Brent, do you have any comments on anything we're working on so far, or?
Absolutely. So I've been really impressed with your staff, and appreciate working with all of you. That MERC grant would not have been as successful as it was without assistance of your staff. Just went, in my opinion, above and beyond. As you mentioned, another member of your staff, Alec, is leading a sidewalk assessment. New highway superintendent, Jordan, and I are looking forward to receiving that. I receive a lot of complaints about our sidewalks, and legitimately so. And I have a lot of personal concern about liability for the town because of the conditions of our sidewalks. But I am on your Brownfields Committee, and I'm on your Moyle Valley Rail Trail Committee. I'm also on, the title escapes me because it just changed 2 months ago, but the Hazard Mitigation Grant Committee, that's been wonderful to be involved in, to be amongst members of other communities, that, and we're all working together to look for solutions for the flooding that seems to be an annual, if not more so, event in Moyle County and beyond. And just putting us all together in the same room and talking about resources, ideas, how we might be able to influence the state. LCPC is, I've seen, able to communicate directly with our congressional liaisons to inform them of issues with FEMA, et cetera. So I've just been very appreciative to work with them. So thank you to you and your staff.
Well, thank you for that. And actually, on the congressional front, I'm not sure if you're all aware that and who knows what will happen with this in the congressional budget discussions now, but we did previously receive notification from Senator Welch's office. We had applied for congressionally directed spending for $500,000 worth of river gauges on the Lamoille River, because we think that is absolutely crucial in terms of informing communities along the way. We had someone from Hardwick come to one of our meetings who basically, you know, said, when the Ford dealership starts moving their trucks, we let people downriver know that something's going to be happening. And that's not super scientific. So, and so we're hopeful that that money will come through as well. And as Brent mentioned, the work on the hazard mitigation, working with the regions in Northeast and Northwestern Vermont, we also have a $500,000 grant to do. Much of that is for modeling of the Lamoille River and identifying projects where we can protect our communities. And we're really excited about that work going forward. Do folks have questions, or?
Tasha, I just want to say to you that how much I appreciate all the things that you and your staff brought to the table for us. In a government glacial movement of most things, you have done yeoman's work in terms of helping us get an amended town plan in place so that we can now qualify for downtown designation. We very much look forward to working with you on bringing that to fruition. I just think that now that we are accepted into LCPC with our approved town plan, I see great partnership there and look forward to it.
Well, that's wonderful. And we look forward to working with you. And I forgot to mention the mapping. We do make a lot of maps for communities. And we're happy to do those. And we often get requests from planning councils and commissions and conservation commissions as well. So yeah, any questions, comments?
All right, thank you.
All right, thank you all so much. I really appreciate it. Thanks.
The next on our agenda is a consideration of an appointment to the Morristown Conservation Commission for Hillary Warner. Mr. Stancliff, would you like to speak to that?
Hi, Ron Stancliff, Chair of the Morristown Conservation Commission. I'm very happy that we have interviewed a possible new member to join our vacancy. And that's why it's before you here tonight. And I'd like to introduce Hillary. So if you have any questions for her, but she's well qualified. She was on a planning commission in New Hampshire when she moved from there to this community.
Good evening. Thanks for having me.
You're welcome. Hillary, would you like to give us a little brief background and why you'd like to serve on the commission?
I love being outside, and I think that having open space and places that people can go and rejuvenate and refresh is really important. And I also think that having clean air and clean water and so forth are a lot of the things that the Conservation Commission is charged with. And everything in their bylaws just lights me up. So I'm really excited to have an opportunity to volunteer.
And you have some past experience, is that correct?
Yes, I was on a conservation commission for a couple of years, and then I segued into our town's local land trust and became the trails director for almost 20 years. And we did use our local planning commission a lot for creating trail maps in that capacity.
Does anybody else on the board have any questions or thoughts?
I just want to thank you for, stepping up to join this. It's so important. I'm a huge advocate of getting as many people and diversify the population involved in all the committees and the boards. And I agree with you. I think this is an incredibly important commission. And Ron has been a huge advocate for many, many years. And he certainly needs some support and help in his endeavor. So I really appreciate it. And I know you've been involved in other things. So I just really want to thank you for joining this.
Well, you're very welcome. I think that many hands make light work.
Yep.
Ron, a technical question. The appointment, do you have terms for your seats on your commission, or is it in perpetuity until they resign or other?
Yes. There was a vacancy this summer by Carrie Anderson, and so she will be fulfilling her complete Carrie Anderson's term.
Okay. Do you know what that term is offhand?
I do not know offhand. I'd have to look in the last year's town report.
Okay. So if a motion was made to fill an expired term, would that suffice?
I think so.
Yeah, I believe so too. So unless anybody else has any other questions for Hillary?
No, I'll make a motion to appoint Hillary Warner to the Morristown Conservation Committee for the remainder of the term left vacant by Carrie Anderson.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, so we have a motion by Richard and a second by George. Is there any other discussion? All those in favor of the motion say aye.
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 Those opposed? It passes unanimous. Thank you. Thank you, Hillary. Thank you, Ron. Next on our agenda is consideration to support the Vermont Department of Forest and Parks and Recreation acquisition of the Elmer Mountain parcel in the town of Morristown. Gunnar, is that correct?
Yeah.
Welcome to our meeting tonight. Would you like to take a few minutes and walk us through it?
Yeah, absolutely. I'm Gunnar Nermy. I'm the Land Acquisition Coordinator with the Vermont Department of Forest, Parks, and Recreation. And as Chris said, we're working on a land conservation project here in Morristown. So as part of our standard process, we come to you tonight to discuss the project and ultimately ask the Select Board support. The parcel that we're looking at acquiring is a 90-acre parcel off of Elmore Mountain Road that would be added to Elmore State Park. The parcel as it currently stands is 138 acres owned by Elmore Mountain LLC, Elmore Mountain Associates LLC, which is a family LLC. But if the project moves forward, we would subdivide the eastern 90 acres on the eastern side of the road that heads up towards Elmore Mountain and the state park and acquire that, leaving the other 48 acres on the western side of the road that has a house in the same ownership. The parcel is attractive to FPRs in addition to the state park for a lot of reasons. The parcel itself is mostly forested, but if you've driven along Elmore Mountain Road, the road frontage is kind of kept brush hogged. It's one of the large fields along the road there. But the majority of the parcel is forested heading up towards Elmore Mountain and the state park. It abuts the state park on the eastern side. FPR does not have any, currently any management access to the western side of Elmore State Park or from the west. We have a small right-of-way access for management, but that's it. So that's one reason that this is attractive for us, is expanding management access to the state park. But not only management access, also public access to the state park. It would provide a new access point. You know, currently Elmore State Park is all over in Elmore by the lake. This would provide a new access point from the west. That doesn't mean necessarily a big parking lot and stuff. That sort of conversation would come later down the line through a long-range management planning process. But as with all FPR lands, if it was acquired by us, immediately it'd be open to dispersed recreation, which is hunting, hiking, snowshoeing, that sort of stuff. So it'd be new access on the western side of Elmore Mountain. I believe at least the 2022 Morristown Town Plan specifically calls for the protection of Elmore Mountain, the western side, because of its scenic values. So we'd be protecting that. Being up there on the mountain, kind of at the end of the Worcester Range, it's part of a really critical wildlife linkage connecting the Worcester Range up north to the Northeast Kingdom. So it's kind of a priority area for FPR to protect land within, because we really see it as a valuable wildlife corridor. There are multiple headwater streams on the parcel that flow to the Lamoille, and given the increased rates of flooding in the Lamoille, we view that as a benefit to help protect water quality and flood resilience downstream. And yeah, those are the big three points, being forest connectivity, added access for recreation and management, and flood resilience. So we applied to federal forest legacy funding to acquire this parcel. If that's successful, it will be added to Elmore State Park and managed as such. But yeah, those are the nuts and bolts. If you're looking at the packet on the maps, the whole parcel is shown, but there's little gray hashes on the portion that would be retained. So we would not be in the western part, just the eastern. But yeah, any questions?
So I have a couple of thoughts. Well, first and foremost, I fully subscribe to people who own any parcels of land in Morristown that should have certain autonomy to be able to do with it what they want. And the Morristown Select Board or anybody else shouldn't act as an overlord saying yes or no. I think that, philosophically, I particularly believe that we're not making any more land, and the opportunity to conserve this is a really good piece of the puzzle for not only Morristown, but for forests and parks as well. My concern, however, is parking. Because if you're, and I've, in your presentation tonight, it's going to open up hiking and other recreational, sort of maybe passive recreational activities on that side. And recreation is a big part of Vermont's identity here, so, and culture. So when you, it concerns me a little bit when you say that parking, a parking area might be somewhere down the road, because the last thing I want to see are cars parked on Elmer Mountain Road in that area, because I don't want to wait for supply and demand to propagate that. So are you in a position to talk to us a little bit about how that can move forward? If you're successful in acquiring the land, that there would be a plan then to put in whatever you needed to do to accommodate off-road parking, because I don't want to see cars, personally, and the board can speak for themselves, but personally don't want to see cars parked there, particularly on a beautiful Saturday afternoon once word gets out.
Yeah, absolutely. I shouldn't have said like much about a parking area, because as of now, there's no plans for that. If and when we acquire the land, from that point until there is a long-range management plan, until the long-range management plan for the Worcester Range, which Elmer State Park is within, is updated to include this parcel, which that would include a public process that the town and anyone could have a say in. Until that point, no parking area would be put in. There wouldn't be any new signage of the property. We wouldn't try to, you know, attract unfit, you know, visitation in that interim period. And then it would be open, you know, if people wanted to walk up there and go hunt or something, it'd be open for that, as with all our lands. But any further development or discussion of parking resources, which may or may not happen, would not be discussed until that long range management planning process.
What's the target date for that to occur, Gunnar?
There's not necessarily a target date for that. The Worcester Range Management Unit just went through an updated planning process, which maybe you're aware of, that was finalized in September. So it's a pretty fresh one. So an entire new plan for the unit is probably a good ways off. But when we acquire just one new parcel like this, we sometimes do plan amendments just for specific reasons, like this might be. So that would be, I can't give a specific time.
Yeah, okay.
It would be a couple of years after acquisition.
So am I also understanding that if you wanted to start to develop hiking trails up from Elmer Mountain Road up to, it looks like the summit's there, whether it's an accessible track up or not, I'm not sure, not having walked that,
yeah.
that wouldn't happen until the long range plan comes as well?
Correct. That would also not happen until that. And again, all of that has a public process.
So somebody could stop there and decide they're gonna walk?
Yes.
Just through the grass or through the woods?
Yeah.
Or hunt there,
yeah.
Which they may be doing now already, depending on what the owner's currently saying.
Yeah, totally.
Okay.
When we acquire the land, we have what we call an interim stewardship plan, which carries the property over until we get to that long range planning process. And the interim plans don't set out, they don't have a public process, but they don't set out anything crazy. It basically generally just says that we will manage the land as it has been, and we won't do anything significant until there's a public process.
Yeah, because I think that this is a wonderful idea. I'm supportive of it. And I think it gives locals as well as tourists an opportunity to see the west side, and if there are trails eventually there, you get a very different view, and that would be really a really nice addition.
Yeah.
But I, like Chris, that road appears to be a kind of sleepy gravel road. It's a pretty high speed gravel road, and I think, you know, a car now and then, we've all got that, but if it starts to be 10-12 cars, because, you know, the one I think of is Green River Reservoir, when it started with when the state first acquired it, that may not have been your department, it may have been. There was one small parking area, and next thing you know, we had cars up in the woods and every place else. And eventually the state compensated for it and built larger lots and obviously pushed out further than had been, but eventually it got adapted. But it was kind of, it felt a little bit backwards. And I think it's hard for, especially Green River, to judge how attractive that lake is and became as it got advertised in very nice ways, but still it started to attract more and more out-of-state plates, and the locals started to fade a little bit because it was just busy. And I would hate to see that repeat with this piece of land where the, need starts first and then we kind of try to adapt. Obviously, at some point, if you were to put in a 20-car lot and you always see we're still on the road, well, that 20-car lot obviously needs to go larger. But as long as the development is coming at the same time, as long with a long-range plan, I don't have a real concern.
It would, yeah.
Okay, thank you.
I think that if for nothing else, out of the conversation, it would, I think I would particularly appreciate, maybe the board would too, as well as administration, that you would share these concerns. Should we, make a motion to do this, which I'm assuming we will this evening, that you would bring those concerns forward to your state agency, just so that, at least right out of the gate, we have shared that.
Absolutely.
Laura, do you have any questions?
I traveled Elmore Mountain Road because I worked at Elmore State Park. I think I saw you up there, actually. I don't think people realize how valuable this park is and how incredibly popular. It's probably one of the busiest parks in the whole state, especially for day use because of its proximity. I mean, it's 5 minutes from downtown Mooresville. And the revenue that that park generates is phenomenal. So the fact that broadening it into Mooresville is absolutely incredible. It's like camel's hump. It's in two towns. Both towns benefit. It disperses some of the traffic eventually. Now, this is down the road, I get. It's way down the road. But I think the potential is phenomenal. It's a wonderful, wonderful park up there. And by us bringing this onto the Mooresville side is an unbelievable opportunity. So thank you for pursuing this, and I'm absolutely gung-ho. And I can tell you, being up at Elmore State Park, trying to walk through that's not gonna be easy. You're not gonna get people, readily hiking until there's, trails.
Yeah.
So I don't find that an issue. If somebody bikes along Elmore Mountain Road and takes off, all the better. So thank you. I think this is great. It's very exciting.
Yeah, and thank you for your words. And I've hiked up in there, and I agree. And I think without any trails or any other infrastructure or signage, I don't foresee there being an issue until the planning process.
Yeah. Tourists won't know about it for a while.
I was going to say, there'll be no different than the typical traffic during hunting season right now, especially if it's not advertised and it's a state lane.
Yeah.
No one's going to change their habits to go there.
Yeah.
Because I run up there, and it's a fun place to.
But you keep going.
Ron, you wanted to speak?
It was on a very quick notice at my last meeting that this came up, but we had time to discuss it and act on it. And I believe there's included in your packet a letter from the commission, thanks to Gary Thone, who wrote it up for me. And I did look at the rest of the packet endorsements by other organizations for this particular project. I see one thing that you might not be aware of, but with the state owning this, it will be open to the public, but right now it's posted. So I think this is something to consider as a benefit to those who love the outdoors and the wildlife that's there. If you haven't walked the property, then you are not familiar with it. Well, I have, or did have, 50 acres that join it beside it on the same side of the mountain. But I deeded that over to my son, and I don't think I'll be posted either. So, and I know there's others here that may want to speak for this. Thank you.
Yeah, there were actually 10 letters of support for this project. Jamie?
James Brewster. And I'm going to go out on a limb here and say in the last 5 years or more, My family and I probably have spent more time in that woodlot going through it than anybody else. We walk our dogs through there, through Ron's property, at least it once, if not twice a week. I think it's a misconception to think that there'll be a lot of people recreating there, parking lot or not. It's a 90-acre parcel, which was logged not too long ago. And if you're not on the woods roads, you're not going anywhere. And when you get to the top of the property, it basically shelves out and goes straight up. I think it's unreasonable to think that there will ever be trails that wrap around to the Elmore side. I just don't see that there are going to be trails in there. For me, it seems as though the state is looking to get this as a means of access for management, probably more than any other thing. I'm not quite sure what that means. But I don't think that, you know, recreation is, you know, one of the primary means, just because there's not a lot of it there. I have a lot of mixed feelings about this particular property going to the state. I guess the biggest one is, I just think it's really unfortunate that to meet the goals of clean air and clean water and wildlife and recreation, we have to take this out of private ownership and put it into public ownership. It just doesn't sit right with me that we as a people, as a community, have to shift our land in that way to meet those objectives. But if that's the way it is, so be it. But I find it unfortunate. And I guess lastly, I would say I will personally volunteer on my own time to go down and remove all of the yellow posted signs that surround that property and dispose of those signs on my own dime.
Is there anyone else? Bob?
Yeah, I think this is a wonderful step forward. I believe our town plan actually indicates that we want to protect the Elmore Reach line. If you look a little bit northeast of that property, there's been a tremendous amount of clearing on that northeastern ridge line. I don't know what's going on up there, but I suspect development. And I don't know how that happened, but it did. It's clearly in the town plan that we wanted to protect that, the Elmore Ridge line. And I think this is a great step forward in doing that. And I wholeheartedly support any lands that we can protect and preserve as part of creating our rural environment and our agricultural heritage. So yes, I absolutely support it.
Okay, anyone else? Jerry?
Jerry Throne. I'm on the Morristown Conservation Commission. And we reviewed the proposal, and we discussed it amongst ourselves in a special meeting that we had. I think it was unanimous that everybody that was present at the meeting on the Morristown Conservation Commission, that this is a great opportunity to preserve property. As you said, property is, land is not being created every day, at least not around here, maybe in Hawaii, but not here. So we believe that this is a great opportunity, and that we should not pass this up as a town.
All right, thank you. Gunnar, did you want to add something more? Or?
No, I just want to make any more questions.
I don't see any other discussion. I certainly would entertain a motion from the board.
I'll make a motion to approve a letter of support for the Vermont Department of Forest, Parks and Recreation's acquisition of the Elmore Mountain parcel in the town of Morristown and authorize Vice Chair Christopher Palermo to sign.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, so we have a motion by Richard and a second by George. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? That would be unanimous, Judy. Thank you, Gunnar.
Yeah, thank you all.
Thank you.
There's a simple letter of support included in the packet.
Yep.
That I may have seen.
And I'll sign it before I leave tonight.
Awesome. Thank you all.
Thank you. So the next on the agenda is a consideration of Morristown Conservation Commission article for town meeting March 2025. Jerry, Ron, who would like to speak to that?
Jerry Throne. Morristown Conservation Commission is an organization that is looking out for everybody's you know, well-being and having an environment that we can all live in and enjoy and recreate in. And so our goals are to expand on forest land and try to accomplish connecting parcels together to make connectivity for animals and people to be able to utilize the land. And so, you know, basically the letter that I drafted, you know, says everything as far as we feel it's important to the community to have proper funding so that we can continue our mission. One of the things that we just found out, we had run a quick survey on Front Porch Forum, and just to see what people's thoughts were. And the result of that was, let me bring that up here, that 100% of those responding to the question, it was one of the questions was, do you believe our community should preserve our open green spaces and rural character? And there were 25 respondents in a 24-hour period. I'm sure when we run this survey a little bit longer, we'll get a lot more participation, but I think 24 out of the 25 live in Morristown. So I think that we have community support, community values the open spaces, community wants to see the open spaces continue and be able to provide places for people to recreate and enjoy animals and keep the environment clean. And so in order to do that, it does take money. And so what we're asking for is to have an article that the voters can vote on and decide whether or not they want to fund this. To try to come up with projects that we can put our finger on right now, well, there is one that will remain unnamed, but it's right next to the town forest. And that's a property that I think it's 50s, 90 acres? How many acres does that run?
A little over 50
acres. A little over 50 acres. It would be a great addition to the town forest. It's also adjacent to the Duhamel property. And so it would have that connectivity there. It's a great wintering area for deer. So that would help preserve the connectivity for the deer that utilize that area. All kinds of wildlife. It would benefit them. And recreating. I know that there's a lot of trails on the Duhamel property that a lot of people here utilize them with their biking trails. That could probably be expanded into this area. And so what we're saying is that if we have some money, we can utilize that as seed money to get grants and from other from agencies and groups, and there are some matching funds that, but we gotta have the seed money first. There are some neighboring communities that have their conservation commissions and boards have done a lot with funds that their voters made available, and to the point of they got at least 3-1, and in one case, it was 14-1 that the matching funds that came in. So, if we have an investment of 20 or 30,000, that could be multiplied by, say, 5 or 6 on average. That's what we're looking to do. Once the funds have been approved by the electors, the voters, it goes into savings fund or CD, whatever, and it's there so that when someone comes to the Conservation Commission and says, I have this property and I'd like to conserve it. By the way, we do have another inquiry that just came up after we met and wrote the letter. And so there is another potential landowner that wants to conserve property, but you know they need to be paid for it. So how long are they going to wait? Well, who knows, but chances are they're not going to wait very long. If we lose them, we lose them, we'll find somebody else. But we've got to have the funds first. That's what has to come first. And then we have the funds, we get these people that want to conserve their property. We come to the select board and we say, we have someone that wants to conserve. This is where it is. These are the acres. This is how much they want. And what can we do to, you know, to bring this forward and make this thing happen? So that's pretty much it in a nutshell, I think, of what I put on paper to you. If you have any questions, I'm happy to answer them. Or I think Ron might have some comments as well. And I think Brent has some comments he wants to make.
I have a couple questions. The first is, would this be an annual? So this is not a one-time. You're asking for an article to authorize a half cent in perpetuity. Is that correct?
That is correct. This is an annual thing. We have been successful in the past and had appropriations. There are, I can't remember the number, but we're not the only conservation commission in Vermont, in the state. I think there's 83 others out of, what, 250 communities in Vermont. And some of them are successful in having appropriations, annual type. Yes, the only way that we can, it's not really an operating cost for us like all these other and things that are coming before the board for, or I should say the property owners. It's like Jerry pointed out, if an opportunity comes up, we don't have an adequate amount that we could even discuss trying to do anything. Jerry mentioned about property owner inquiring. Actually, a week ago today, my wife answered the phone and handed it over to me. But it was an individual in Morristown that has a business acreage at the end of Cody Hill. And it's known as the, I think it's the Northern Trails Organization. 148 acres, I think is up there. This individual has already inquired of Vermont Land Trust and Nature Conservancy, but didn't have any success. I did think of the success that we had a year ago where an individual conserved some land through the New England Forest Foundation. And so I gave him this information. He had a reply today. But anyway, I know this is a difficult thing for you, the board, to consider, but you're putting it on the agenda is really going before the voters. And if, in that case, that's when we've got to go out and try and encourage the voters to authorize this particular expense in addition to.
Can I ask you another question? Has this not been an article on the ballots before by petition?
I do not believe it has been.
I think it has been. And why I'm asking is because I think in our bylaws, there's a provision that says that articles can only be
repeated
a certain amount of time, so we would just need to check some technical viability. I know this has been on there at one point in time, but I just want to make sure that before we spend too much time, that we legally can.
Yeah.
Well, to be honest with you, I don't anticipate the board taking any action on this tonight.
Yeah, but.
We don't begin our budget process until Wednesday, when we begin to discuss all things budget Wednesday afternoon, or we begin the conversation. So I anticipated the presentation by Jerry and yourself, Ron. We would take this forward, and it would wrap into a general discussion about the budget, and then we would make decisions from there.
But we need to know if we can legally even do it.
And we can do that as part of our conversation.
Would we be invited to that, or is that just a discussion amongst the board?
There's going to be multiple meetings. I guess I envision, and I'll let Brent, he's the town manager, sort of script this out. Before I talk anymore, why don't you tell them what you have in your mind's eye in terms of moving forward?
So Wednesday's meeting is going to be my proposed budget to the select board to share with the select board and the community, follow open meeting laws, and to start the conversation. It's going to be a working meeting, so the public is welcomed, but we'll get through that process. Select board, at the end of my presentation, we'll have questions. After the select board's questions, then the chair can open it up to public comments. There'll be other meetings for December that just haven't been scheduled yet, but there'll be other, you know, a couple other meetings in December, and then in January, there'll be an additional, what is it called?
Pie for breakfast.
Pie for breakfast. You'd think I'd remember that. So that's how Wednesday's meeting is going to go, and all people are welcome in person via Zoom.
And it will be open for public discussion. I didn't think it was going to be.
At the end, it'll be open for people who want to.
I think that the intention is that that's a pretty brief window, just to get some general conversation.
Well, because they haven't been in the past, so.
So the new open meeting laws, when they change, there has to be a community comment section on every board agenda. Yeah, so by law.
Okay.
Thank you. Brent?
My name is Brent Tan. I just want to make a very quick comment to show you the support that this has had in the past. In 22, this was Article 12, and it received 855 votes versus 500 in that past. In last 23, this was an article that was in there. And as you recall, in 23, there weren't many budgets passed on anything. Maybe budgets were a hard deal at that particular time. But this particular article was in there again. It was Article 13. And the yeses were 886, the noes were 926. So it lost by about 46 votes. So my reason for presenting this is just to show you that there's a lot of interest from the people of Morristown in this particular amendment. Thank you.
Yep, thanks, Brent.
Yeah, I guess I'd like to understand what the half cent is.
It's about $56,000. A penny raises about $112,000.
Okay. And this wouldn't have a direct effect on the municipal budget. This is sort of an ask like the Noise House or any of the other organizations that ask for additional funding aside from the municipal budget. Am I correct in that?
That's correct. So any special article, including the service agencies, you know, the municipal budget is our services that we provide. Any additional add-ons just makes the tax rate go up, essentially.
So it has to pass on its own. It has no really individual relationship to the municipal budget, so it's a up or down vote, whether people support it or not.
Right, it's a standalone.
Okay.
And as he stated, it's been on both the 22 and 23 ballots already.
Thank you.
Yep, Ellen.
Evelyn Throne, I'm not on the MCC, but I sit, I'm at all their meetings.
you participated in all.
I might as well be.
You're collateral damage.
Yeah, but basically, if it can be put on the budget, on the ballot, that would be really great. I think that possibly one of the things is the MCC hasn't always taken the time to really give a lot of outreach, and I think that that's something that we're really looking forward to doing. It'll be a good way to help people understand what we do. Also, I'd like to make a note that this, you know, now that we're following the town plan and we're working in it, this really does dovetail with the town plan. This is what we're committed as a town plan to do, is to conserve land and to look at the whole town holistically. So I think that, you know, that's a something that we'll be talking about as we go forward.
Okay, thank you, Evelyn. Anything else? Okay, thank you very much, Ron and Jerry, for your presentation. Is there any old business? None. Okay. So our next item agenda is to approve the warrants. Do we have a motion?
So moved.
We have them here, correct?
Yeah.
Yep, we'll let her look at them if she'd like to. So we have a motion by George. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, second by Richard. Is there any further discussion?
Yep.
Is there any further discussion?
I want to say that's just the signatures.
Yeah, I want the bills.
The bills are online, right?
The bills are online now.
They're all online now.
You should have been sent information from that.
I did receive that. I didn't understand what it was. Okay, I'll go back.
I can help you if you call.
That's, yeah, I will. I was like, I'm not putting in bills. I thought I was I get billing statements.
But you set up a login and then you can view all of the.
That's great, yeah, thank you for that. Sorry, I looked at that closer.
So we have a motion by George and a second by Richard. Is there any other discussion on the warrants? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Motion passes and that's unanimous, Judy. Community comments. Evelyn?
Which hat you wearing this time?
A resident. I'm a Evelyn Throne resident of Morrisville. I was hoping that we could move forward with whatever traffic study that LCPC can help us with. And I know that there's a whole lot of thought that goes with that. It's a very complex issue. On a very more simple note, I'm going to hammer on my thing that I've talked about before. Maple Street and Congress are just raceways. The way people drive, like we're always yelling, that's not 25 as they go by, but that, you know, how much does that help? And we're always trying to plan where the traffic tables should be and how we could put signage and you know, so that people would know that that's not a raceway. They'd get used to it very quickly. But that's just one certain point. But I think that could be part of the traffic study. And I would be thrilled if we could get this, you know, the parking and the traffic study further along, but especially the speedways taken care of.
All right, thanks, Evelyn. Anyone else?
I would like to make a comment. I don't know if everyone's aware that Gail Beck, our communities and activity director, I don't think that's not the appropriate title right now, but she put on a turkey trot, the third annual turkey trot Thanksgiving morning, and there are 251 competitors, I'll use that term loosely. A bunch of people walked and enjoyed a trip in the snow on Thanksgiving Day, and It went, in my vision, it went as smoothly as it could have possibly gone. There were no hiccups that were visible to anyone except for the people that were working. But I'd like to thank Gail for that.
And honestly, that's a doubling of the number of last year.
Yeah.
And it was, the weather was horrible.
The weather's fantastic.
Oh, well, I mean, it's relative, but you know.
Okay, thank you. Meeting schedule. We have our workshop on Wednesday, December 4th, from 4 to 9 p.m. That's what we are warned for. If we get through the meeting prior to that, we will adjourn at that point. We have that window of time that we've been warned for, but if the meeting lasts 3.5 hours, 4 hours, and we've come to a conclusion, then the meeting will come to a conclusion. Monday, December 16th, we have a select board meeting, or a regular meeting at 5:30. And then a reminder that Saturday, January 4th, we will be doing a community meeting day at the school, supply for breakfast, and it will be in the PHM. That's scheduled to run from 8 a.m. to noon. Absolutely.
Judy Alberry, executive assistant. I need pies. So there's going to be a cry for pies. A cry for pies for community meeting day. I'm looking for 20 pies. And we'll do very similar to what we did last year. The Euro Club will serve the pies. At the end of the meeting, after social services will be there setting up tables like we did last year. They're excited to come back. They'll give their little spiel to everybody. And at the end, if there's any pies left over, the Euro Club did a auction, take a pie for a certain dollar amount, whatever you want to pay. They're going to do that again. So I am going to be asking probably Gail to help out, assist me in getting pies. But if anybody out there is watching and listening and you want to bring a pie, 8 o'clock in the morning, we need the pies at the PA gym, please. And we'll take any kind of pie, pizza pie, breakfast pie, gluten-free pies, chocolate cream pies. I don't care. Just pies.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. Thanks, Judy.
Judy, I can offer, it's a long story, but I processed like close to 40 cups of squash pumpkin, very sweet.
Nice.
So if somebody's so inclined and needs some squash, I'm happy to donate some because I'm out of freezer space.
Jerry's got his hand up already. And it's not for him.
Is it Blue Hubbard?
It is Blue Hubbard.
Oh my God, that's the best.
I got a 20 pounder. And
oh, I did too. But I did get my.
I did too, and I still had 30 cups. Yeah.
I don't think that's an agenda.
No.
Squash
discussion.
There is no other business, I presume, so I would entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All right. Thank you all very much.
Sorry, I tried to behave so well.